Hello, I'm Ken Seri, a colleague of George Meek, who I will introduce to you shortly. Since the beginning of human life on this planet, perhaps 200,000 years ago, our ancestors have wondered whether their minds, memory banks, personalities, and souls pass away with the death of the physical body. Or do they live on? There have been many beliefs and opinions on both sides of the fence, but no hard and conclusive evidence one way or the other, until now. Thanks to astonishing modern research, more light has been shed on this mystery in recent few decades than in the previous tens of thousands of years of civilization. The people involved in this research have included medical doctors, psychiatrists, scientists, engineers, technicians, psychologists, hypnotherapists, and psychically gifted persons all over the globe. This loosely organized and informal group of curious, courageous professionals has often worked without pay. They have sometimes been subject to ridicule by their friends and colleagues as they assembled hard evidence that the human mind, memory banks, personality, and soul do indeed live on. As you will soon see, they have succeeded astonishingly well in their research. Now, for the first time in history, it can be said with certainty that you, the viewer, will survive death of your physical body. No ifs, no ands, no buts, no maybes. There are 5 billion people in the world today, some educated, others illiterate. But educated or not, all are still searching for a soul-satisfying answer to their own questions on the ultimate mystery of life. This videotape provides those answers. This truly incredible breakthrough could best be presented by the man who conceived, organized, and financially supported major segments of this worldwide research. That man, 24 years into his second career, is George W. Meek of Franklin, North Carolina. Permit me to introduce you to George Meek.
Thanks, Ken, for that lengthy but very necessary background reading. And greetings to all of you who have ever pondered that ages-old question, what, if anything, will happen to me after my funeral or trip to the crematory? As Ken just remarked, this videotape answers that question to a degree never before possible in the history of the human race. I am very happy to be able to share with you our 23 years of research into the basic nature of man. I want to open with a little joke that is particularly appropriate for the subject matter I will share with you now. A motorist stopped in a small town and asked directions to the town hall, explaining to a local man, "Tonight I'll be delivering a lecture there entitled, How to Get to Heaven. Say, how would you like to come? Free of charge." The local man pondered, shook his head, "No thanks. Well, you don't even know how to get to the town hall." Well, that little story is good for a smile. It is also very appropriate to the presentation that we will make today. 2,000 years ago, Jesus talked about the kingdom of heaven. He used poetic language when he referred to his Father's house of many mansions. Now, in semi-scientific language, I will tell you where those mansions are, of what they are constructed, who lives in which mansions, and, in fact, give you some idea as to which mansion you yourself are heading for. A tall order. Approaching age 84, I have a tendency to ramble, so allow me to follow closely my prepared text. More has happened in just the past 30 years to document survival of human consciousness than in 8,000 years of recorded history. I want to acquaint you with some astonishing research results whereby electronic equipment has been used to converse with persons who died 25, 50, and 100 or more years ago. I will also share with you examples of both computer and prolonged mental telepathy contacts with Jeanette, who was my beloved wife for 55 years and my research co-worker for 30 years. And I will show you why and how your very own mind, memory banks, personality, and soul will continue to function after you someday cast off that physical body in which you are currently encased. In fact, I will show you how you can have a happy forever. I will address three crucial questions. How? What? Where? First, how is survival of your individual mind, memory banks, personality, and soul possible? Second, what evidence is there for survival of your individual consciousness? And third, where will you, as an individual, find yourself after you go through the door which mankind has mistakenly labeled death? So let's address that first question. How is survival of your individual mind, memory banks, personality, and soul possible? To answer this first question, I will summarize what our 23 years of worldwide research have revealed about the basic nature of man. Now I will share a lot of information with you in the form of slides. Man is both physical and non-physical. Each of us has our own well-known physical body, but we also have a non-physical body. Occupying the same space as our physical body, this non-physical body is generally called the etheric or bioplasmic body. This bioplasmic body is non-physical. It consists of a complex of energy fields, one for each of our bodily organs and components. Some may ask, well, what is an energy field? This slide shows the normally invisible energy field surrounding a compass needle and around a leaf. On the right, we have a newly cut privet plant leaf, and you see the energy field extending out there. And on the magnetic needle from a compass, you see around the point of the of that needle, the energy field extending out into space. Here we see a normally invisible energy field surrounding a bar magnet. Notice how intricate and complex this field is. Now, this normally invisible field of energy can easily penetrate flesh and blood and bones, as shown here. Here, the energy field of an electromagnet easily passes through the physical flesh and bone of my hand and just temporarily organizes thousands of small particles of iron, holding them together. In spite of the force of gravity, in the same manner, the invisible energy fields of your etheric body organize more than 60 billion cells in your physical body structure, just as did the field at one pole of this magnet, which organized the iron filings. If we turn off the current of this electromagnet, of course, those thousands of iron filings immediately fall to the ground. To create the fields of the etheric or bioplasmic body, cosmic energy flows in the acupuncture meridians and through the nadis of what is called the chakra system, and temporarily organizes or animates the billions of cells in your physical body. But now for the first exciting news. The brain is not the mind. The brain is largely physical matter, while the mind is non-physical, a bundle of energy fields. The little figure at the right there is a totem pole indicating that the American Indians and the Polynesians knew about these three levels of mind hundreds and hundreds of years before the birth of Sigmund Freud and his collaborators. It helps if we understand that the brain is a piece of hardware. It serves as a computer, but a computer infinitely more complex and advanced than any computer yet conceived of by man. But we have learned that no computer hardware is of value without a programmer, that is, some intelligence quite separate from the computer hardware. And this is where the non-physical and normally invisible mind comes in. It serves as a programmer for the computer-like brain. This invisible complex of non-physical energy fields is nicely assembled in a package, which we call the astral body, the mental body, or what St. Paul, 2,000 years ago, called the spiritual body. It consists of our subconscious, conscious, and superconscious minds, and what is our most precious possession, our very own soul. These mind fields and soul are connected to the computer through an invisible, and I stress normally invisible, cable called the silver cord. This was referred to as far back as the book of Ecclesiastes in the Bible. Today we hear about people going out of body or doing astral travel. This non-physical, so-called silver cord keeps us attached to our computer-like brain, even though our astral body may travel many miles away on a trip. But if this connecting cord or wiring harness breaks for any reason, such as accidental or natural death, the computer, the brain, becomes a piece of junk, and the physical body immediately dies, starts to disintegrate, decays, and becomes disorganized, just as did those thousands of iron filings when the electric current was turned off. But equally exciting is the evidence that the astral body, with its level of minds, personality, its memory banks, and soul, are still vibrantly alive after the death and decay of the brain. They move on to other levels of existence, which we will be discussing shortly. In 1981, my colleague, William O'Neill, and I had more than 20 hours of two-way voice communication with the American scientist, Dr. George Jeffries Mueller. When we talked to Dr. Mueller via electronic equipment in 1981, he had died and been buried 14 years earlier, yet it was Dr. Mueller's astral or etheric body with which we were talking. His superb mind, memory banks, personality, and soul were just as alive as when he had been directing a large staff of scientists in the U.S. space program. Let me pause to anticipate and answer the question. Meek, were you in fact communicating with Dr. Mueller, who had lived and died 14 years earlier? In answer, I make this statement. In 1982, the greatest complex of communication laboratories in the world spent 4 months using their sophisticated voice analysis and synthesis equipment while studying our audio tapes. Their conclusion was, and I quote, "You and O'Neill did not possess the knowledge, the financial resources, nor the equipment to create such recordings. Hence, we indicate our high esteem of your research by offering you free of charge the privilege of tapping the knowledge and experience of our more than 10,000 scientists, engineers, and technicians." Enables us to begin to understand the very complex process by which telepathic channeling works. The person who wishes to serve as a channel for a non-physical intelligence uses his or her personal processes of mental and spiritual attunement, which in effect says, "Okay, I will temporarily and partially turn my mind off. Then you can take a turn at being the programmer and use my computer, my brain, to bring your thoughts through me. You may operate my vocal cords to speak the words, or move my fingers to operate the typewriter or computer keys, or you can use my fingers to hold a pen to write and put your thoughts on paper, so-called automatic writing. When you have finished your communication, I will throw the switch and, in effect, fully reconnect my own silver cord. This understanding about the continuing life of the astral body also provides a sound basis for contemplating the subject of possession. In some cases, after death, the physical body will stay close to the surface of planet Earth and make an attempt to get back into the body of a living person. Such an action can cause great mental confusion to the rightful occupant of that physical body. A case of two or even more, sometimes many more, intelligences fighting to program the same computer. It has been estimated by our communicators in the higher realms of spirit world that perhaps a minimum of 20% of all persons now in mental hospitals the world over and 20% of all the criminals now in all the world's penitentiaries are victims of just such a possession as is diagrammed here. Now, some of you may think this idea of the astral body serving as a programmer is just theoretical and has no basis in fact. Allow me to present evidence to the contrary. In 1978, I photographed my own astral body. I was sitting in my laboratory on this chair. I turned off the normal illumination and used certain wavelengths of ultraviolet light and an 18A filter on black light fluorescent tubes. Here is the projection of my astral body captured on film. It is shown at the lower left. Note that when my astral body was projected, my physical body became transparent. Here you see the back of the chair as the camera looks right through 8 inches of flesh, blood, and bones to the chair back. My body is transparent. And note the light activity at my crown chakra. Later, I will show you how this transparent effect was reproduced at my wife's funeral. While she lay in a closed and locked casket. In this color photo, you see a more complete view of the energy field complex, which was the projection of my astral body. 50 years earlier, Dr. Walter Russell, in his book, The Secret of Light, said, quote, "The mind is light. The mind is a white light centering source from which projects two parallel streams of energy, which are cyclical in nature." Here in my own astral body photo, note the two streams of energy projecting from the right and left hemispheres of my mind. Note that they are indeed cyclical in nature, as Dr. Russell clairvoyantly saw and reported 50 years earlier. Actually, the clarity of these two streams is better shown in another slide. Science demands replication of research work. Well, here is a second projection of my mind fields, this time complete with a silver cord, which you'll notice going across the bottom of the photo. Here again, note that my leg is transparent, and you can see and count upholstery tacks, which are out of sight behind my trousered leg. Next, let's compare the photo of my astral body, which I showed in the preceding slide, with a diagram I made 2 years before I obtained that photograph. The concepts are surprisingly similar. Incidentally, here you can see Dr. Russell's two cyclical streams a little more clearly. Now, if you think this is all very theoretical, permit me to share these two slides of personal research which utilized this knowledge of the profound capabilities of the non-physical human mind and its ability to use thought creatively or destructively. Here, 19 years ago, I projected my thoughts via those two light beams from my mind fields into the water which was used on the radishes in three adjacent small, clear plastic greenhouses. Those radishes which got water into which I had projected negative thoughts, the radishes at the top, did not grow as well and did not develop as much leaf structure as the radishes at the bottom into which I had projected positive thoughts. In both cases, I deposited my thought energy into the water, which was daily poured on the radishes, by another person. I never saw the radishes during their growing period. An additional experiment, also 19 years ago, in which my mind feels influenced growing plants, was even more dramatic. At the time of planting, I encouraged one row of 18 gladiolus bulbs to grow and produce lovely flowers. 17 of the 18 bulbs eventually produced beautiful flowers. The adjacent row of 18 bulbs, only 30 inches away, received and followed my negative mental emotional programming to not produce any buds whatsoever. They obeyed. Not even one of the 18 plants formed a flower bud. The little diagram at the lower right depicts the two energy streams from my mind interacting with the mind field of a bulb. I share just one additional example of the reality of projected thought. My research colleague, Dr. Will Thorner, spent 15 years developing an electronic instrument which could be triggered by thought. This device in Dr. Thorner's laboratory on English Channel was activated by his thoughts when he was 140 miles away in Ireland. I personally operated the device by my focused thoughts at a distance of some 15 feet. With the help of the information in these 19 slides, we have answered our how question. You can now more easily comprehend that the mind, memory banks, personalities, and soul are not physical, and how they transcend time and space, and how they survive death of the physical body. Now let us consider the second question. What evidence is there for the survival of human consciousness? Well, the libraries in England, Brazil, and USA contain many thousands of volumes relating to mediumistic or channeled information from the worlds of spirit. The remarks I will now make result from my own sampling of such books and my unique opportunity for 23 years of personal contact with dwellers in the spirit worlds through the channeling capabilities of these people. For each of 11 years, I went to England to work with Bertha Harris, one of England's greatest 20th century psychics and all-around channels. I shared her talents with my countrymen when I took her on a lecture tour across the USA in 1973. For 20 years, I have worked with Sarah Hieronymus. She channeled a book dictated from the astral planes by a team of 25 of the great authors of the past 75 years. She also channeled for Dr. William Francis Gray Swan. a British-American scientist who had assembled in the spirit world a team of 400 scientists and technicians to work with us on an electronic communication equipment project for communication with the spirit world. My colleague Bill O'Neill was highly clairaudient and clairvoyant. He telepathically conversed with Dr. Mueller for 2 years while Dr. Mueller helped us to develop the electronic equipment on which we then had more than 20 hours of two-way conversations with him in 1981, as I reported earlier in this talk. This woman, working in my laboratory in 4 years, channeled via the word processor more than 3,000 pages of material from dozens of famous people before the channeling became defective due to the impingement of dark forces. I'm sorry to say that I could write a book on that subject. Lucille McNames has for the past 23 years channeled for extraterrestrial dwellers on other planets, members of intergalactic spacecraft crews, and my personal scientist friends in spirit, Dr. Mueller, Dr. Swan, and Dr. Walter Russell. Leslie Flint of London, England, has for 40 years been perhaps the world's most famous direct voice medium, that is, not using mental telepathy. Several hundred hours of transmission via Leslie Flint with great and also very humble people are available. I might explain for a moment, very few people have had any access to this type of channeling. It requires a very special person, I only know of 10 so far in the last 100 years, from which dwellers in the spirit world can extract ectoplasm and create in the etheric realm a voice box through which the spirit speaks, completely bypassing the channel's mind and memory banks. It's about as near a direct instrumental communication as is possible. So it is with the background of my research with these seven and dozens of other persons that I express these five personal observations about other world communicators. First, where are the spirit worlds? They extend from this very room where there are probably hundreds of spirit beings listening to this talk, to the farthest reaches of space. The lowest three ranges are referred to as the astral levels, then the mental causals, and then the celestial planes, and on out into the cosmos. But instead of imagining these spirit realms as layers, zones, or planes, it is more realistic and far more scientific to visualize them as different frequencies or wavelengths of energies, just as as hundreds of invisible radio and TV signals are occupying this room at this moment. Second question, what categories of consciousness are involved? Nature spirits, the human line of evolution, non-human beings, angelic beings, celestial beings, dwellers on other planets, UFO crew members, intergalactic beings. The third question is, which of these eight levels of intelligence have been encountered by telepathic channeling? Well, the answer is all of them. from nature spirits to intergalactic beings who live in other parts of our solar system? Fourth question was, do space or time pose barriers to instrumental communication or telepathic channeling? No, the spirit worlds are timeless. Serial time does not exist. Space is no barrier. Recently, my octogenarian friend, Mrs. McNames, whose picture you saw a moment ago, typed out a chapter for a new book as rapidly as she telepathically heard the words. The words were dictated by a scientist living on the star Alioth, located in the heavenly constellation known as Ursa Major, popularly called the Big Dipper. This star is so distant that if the message had come at the speed of light, it would have traveled at 660 million miles per hour, 24 hours a day, for 80 years. Science has no explanation as how this is possible. And fifth question, of what material or substance do these interpenetrating spirit worlds consist? Again, science has no answer to this question. In our present state of ignorance, we can only say that it consists of what has traditionally been called ether. In our chart on the basic nature of man, we refer to it as a sea of consciousness. Time does not permit a detailed answer. Incidentally, current research has shown that this sea of consciousness can be tapped by devices which will, in the 21st century, provide limitless amounts of usable energy at any spot on the Earth, with none of the problems of fossil fuels. And in this case, the fuel itself will be free of cost, except for the machinery needed to tap the energy. The first global conference on these so-called free energy devices took place in Switzerland 2 years ago. The third conference is scheduled later this year in the USA. Now let us resume our survey of evidence for survival of human consciousness. I held a press conference in the ballroom of the National Press Club in Washington, D.C. on Good Friday morning 11 years ago to announce to the medium our successful logging of more than 20 hours of communications with Dr. George Jeffries Mueller, who I have already introduced to you. Then Jeanette and I took our fifth trip around the world and disseminated the news worldwide. Our goal was merely to stimulate further worldwide research by younger persons who were more qualified for such research than we were. As an aside, I might say history has shown it usually takes at least 25 years for a revolutionary advance to become commonly accepted. But that 1982 effort has paid off handsomely. Now, 11 years later, researchers are contacting the so-called dead via radio-like devices, video screens, telephone answering machines, and computer. In England, Ken Wilber has used several computers to talk with intelligences which use 15th and 16th century English. Serious research indicates the validity of these communications. In Germany and in the United States of America, there are now several hundred members in organizations researching what is called the electronic voice phenomenon, or EVP, using simple tape recorders. There are several researchers in Germany who have had prominent success with video screens, radio-like devices, and computers. In Luxembourg, my research colleagues, Jules and Maggie Harsh-Fishback, have had the most spectacular results. Currently, they have almost daily use of the telephone answering machine for contacts with a woman scientist from a parallel universe. And periodic success with computer and video for persons who have made the transition during the last 10 to 100 or more years. When I was in Luxembourg in 1990, my 65th trip to Europe, I was hoping that Jeanette, as I said, my wife for 55 years, would communicate. She had made the transition to the spirit worlds 90 days earlier on April 25, 1990. The president of the Swiss Parapsychology Society and I were working furiously Saturday and Sunday, helping to make some modifications in the apparatus, and did not have time for my personal research. However, at the very end of Sunday afternoon, when the computer was printing out the summary of our weekend collaboration with residents of the spirit world, the unexpected happened. The computer printer stopped. It had finished its task. But then it started up again. It indexed itself back to the lower left-hand corner and printed out, "Hello, sweetheart, Jeanette." Weekends later, via mental telepathy, Jeanette confirmed her presence in Luxembourg during this hectic weekend. Now I would like to share with you an even more dramatic example of computer contact with Jeanette through Luxembourg, a contact which was followed within 4 hours in the USA by a confirming telepathic contact through her former nurse, Lori. On February 20, 1991, I sat at my desk holding the Luxembourg correspondence file in my hand as I prepared to write my friends in Luxembourg to ask if they had any news from Jeanette. At that moment, the telephone rang. It was a call from my colleagues, Jules and Maggie, in Luxembourg. With great excitement, they reported that they had just received via computer a message in German addressed to them. This was followed by a letter message in English from Jeanette to me. The computer printout had no spaces between the words. I will now read a condensed and slightly paraphrased version. It begins, "Dear GW, well, it seems that there are still people who do not believe in the contacts your friends here in Luxembourg are having. Hence, I will give you some personal details known only to you and Molly. Give Molly my warmest greetings. I miss her. Nobody can know how much. First story, 1987, end of April, our rental tenant, Debbie, called to say that her refrigerator was off. It must have been on a Thursday morning and had no connection with the storm the day before. At the close of her workday, she called again to say she was having more trouble. This time she had left her purse on the seat of the car of the lady with whom she had been riding. This lady lived quite far from Franklin, so Debbie asked to borrow our key to her place. My second story. On April 29, 1987, Anne Valentine wrote a letter from California saying she had not received the so-called Magic of Living Forever booklets which she had ordered, but instead had received a box of Harlequin novels. Third story, John Lathrop shut off the electricity at our rental house to put in a new yard light. He wasn't down there very long, but charged $20 service in addition to $40 for the public bulb, for the bulbs plus tax. The charge seemed high. I might explain that my dear wife came of Scotch ancestry, and she was always very, very frugal, a talent which I appreciated very much over the half century that we were together. Jeanette continued on the computer printout, "Don't try to explain this, honey. My never-ending love to you. I miss you so much, but I know we will be together. I have a big job to do here as a result of that idiot's war. Love forever, JDM. I might mention that Jeanette was serving as a guardian angel of love and kindness, receiving men and women and children victims of the Mideast War as they came out of the discharge end of the so-called tunnel. and she reported they were coming in far larger numbers than indicated by the news media. Jeanette then addressed Maggie. Please, Maggie, forward this to George. He can be a great help to you all. Send my best wishes to Lori also. Thank you, Jeanette Duncan Meek. Well, I knew that examples 1 and 3 were totally factual, but I was at a loss as to number 2, relating to the shipment of books to California. I had had no contact with Ann Valentine in California in 2 years, so I telephoned and read the item to her. She laughed, and recalling the unusual incident, said, yes, Jeanette is 100% correct. Neither she nor I ever learned where that box of cheap love stories came from. And to add to the mystery, they were all used books. Well, in recalling these 3 highly evidential incidents, my companion for 55 years certainly planned and executed a remarkable personal message, one that leaves little room for a skeptic to doubt that the originator of this message via computer was other than Jeanette Duncan Meek. But the story continues. 4 hours later, Jeanette's former nurse and telepathic channel, Lori, got a signal and went into trance. I then say, Lori indicates she has an energy which would like to speak to me. If you come in the name of the Christ, welcome. Good afternoon, honey. Well, good afternoon to you, sweetheart. Have you received a message from Jules and Maggie Harshfish back? I most certainly did this afternoon, just 4 hours ago. Thank you for the wonderful message you brought through via computer in Luxembourg. Well, I just wanted to feel useful. I decided this was a good way to do it. Then, for the next 20 minutes, Jeanette and I utilized Lori's superb mental telepathy abilities to discuss the book Jeanette and I had been co-authoring for the past 5 months. As of now, we are only beginning to dimly comprehend the modus operandi of mental telepathy. We do, however, have reason to believe that most of the items pictured in this diagram play parts in the process. Items such as the crown and throat chakras, the pineal and pituitary glands, and so forth. But ignorance of the process itself has not prevented me from utilizing same. I now share with you another fascinating and true story. When Jeanette, at age 80, became terminally ill, I established a private nursing facility in our home. One of the 2 round-the-clock nurses turned out to be a superb psychic. Her mental telepathy capabilities equaled the very best of the psychically endowed persons I had uncovered in 2 decades of worldwide search for psychically gifted persons. Even if the nurse, Lori, was off duty and 10 miles away, she was not only telepathically tuned into Jeanette, but she could monitor the functioning of Jeanette's physical body and its processes. In the closing months, a series of strokes left Jeanette paralyzed. She could not see or hear and had to be fed 1 spoon of soft food at a time. Yet I was able to converse with her via Lori. I got Jeanette to promise to attempt to co-author with me 1 or 2 books on life after death, and after she was settled in the spirit worlds. In view of her painful and distressing situation, I encouraged Jeanette to make her transition by using all of the persuasion I could muster. 3 times she got partway through the tunnel. Each time she came back and sheepishly said, well, honey, I just did not want to leave you and Lori. Incidentally, Hieronymus Bosch painted this picture of passing through the tunnel almost 500 years before Moody, Kubler-Ross, Ring, and others started to explore the matter in this century. Then down to 65 pounds and a mere skeleton covered with flesh, Jeanette finally accepted the situation and went through the tunnel, so to speak. Within 7 weeks of her transition, telepathic contact was reestablished. And what has happened since then has been nothing less than history-making. In the almost 3 years since Jeanette's transition, and with Lori's help, Jeanette and I have had 102 one-on-one conversations, averaging, I would say, some 25 to 30 minutes each. These conversations have also included our deceased parents, my sisters, personal friends, our daughter, who died at the age of 2 weeks and is now as a beautiful, who died at the age of 2 weeks, 52 years ago, and now appears as a beautiful woman of 25. Two friends who were in our weekly meditation group, Marion McCracken, a founder of the Mountain Light Network, and many, many others. Jeanette herself arrived at the middle of the highest astral plane, but with her loving nature and actions, she had within a few months earned promotion to the mental plane. At that point, she shed her astral body and continued functioning in what is traditionally called the mental body. Her continuing spiritual growth has made this slide out of date. 8 months ago, she and I discussed her most recent advancement to the celestial plane. What an exciting tape recording that is. Now, over a period of 12 months, Jeanette has helped in co-authoring our first book manuscript entitled The Certainty of Living Forever. In our first book, we report on the special birthday and graduation party Jeanette and I staged in place of the conventional funeral service. We tell how Jeanette affected color photographic film while her cast-off body lay in a sealed casket. After the people had left the chapel, I installed a special mixture of white lights, ultraviolet, and infrared lights. We then took a series of 18 photographs, perhaps 1 minute apart. In this photo, number 9, I am standing at the head of the closed and sealed casket. Note the largely concealed tote board behind my lower back, and note the wallpaper decoration on the wall behind my shoulder. In this next photo, number 10, taken perhaps 1 minute later, you note that the upper part of my body has become totally transparent. You can also see the details of the wallpaper and the tote board, both of which should be out of sight behind my body. Now recall that this effect of seeing through 8 inches of my torso was reported earlier in this talk. In our book, we tell what Jeanette later telepathically reported as to the role that she had played in creating this effect at our own funeral. We also tell of our conversation 7 weeks later, after her funeral service, when she humorously expressed her disapproval of my using one particular color slide in illustrating the history of her life. In the almost 3 years since transition, Jeanette and I have generated material which we will soon be editing for our second book, tentatively entitled, What It's Like in Heaven. Now for the third and final portion of this talk, I will address very briefly the questions, where will you as an individual find yourself after you go through the door marked death? Many of you already know from the research of Moody, Kubler-Ross, Ring, and others that a person emerging from the tunnel sees a bright light and is greeted by loved ones and angelic helpers. Then the past life review takes place. Later, depending on the nature of one's death, the new arrival is given a period of tender, loving care and possibly a period of sleep. Upon awakening, one finds oneself very much alive. In Jeanette's case, she reported to me, "Honey, when I woke up and I found I no longer had a physical body, I went into a state of shock. So I just went back to sleep again." Each of us, after a period of rest and recuperation, finds we are on one of three levels of existence. These three levels are commonly called lowest astral, the middle astral, and the highest astral. These levels are described in detail on the chart accompanying my 1978 book entitled After We Die, What Then? Since I do not know you individually, I cannot tell you on which plane you will find yourself. However, this diagram gives you the first clue, the width, and I repeat, the width of the arrow is roughly proportionate to the number of persons in each of these three categories. Category C at the right, made up of greedy, cruel, selfish, materialistic, highly egotistic, unloving persons, including, for example, swindlers, rapists, unrecovered drug addicts, sex perverts, murderers, hardened criminals, and political despots. These will find themselves on the lowest astral planes. And I hope that none of my listeners to this videotape are in this category C. B is the average kind-hearted, considerate, well-meaning, hard-working adult. And all infants and children will arrive on the middle astral planes. A, individuals who have made more than average spiritual progress in this or past lives, and whose souls have evolved to the point that they just naturally are living their present lives in harmony with the characteristics depicted in this next diagram. If you want to increase your chances of being in group A and arrive on the highest astral, you should start now to follow this time-proven path to a happy forever. Seek first the consciousness of God, the Creator. Learn to know yourself and love your real self. Next, love others. Show compassion. Radiate kindness. Practice patience. Share with others. Continue to grow mentally. Serve others. In case you are curious as to Jeanette's path, I told you she arrived on the middle of the highest astral plane. After 6 months, she had shed her astral body and graduated to the mental planes. At this point, she was generally knowledgeable on the details of the lowest, middle, and highest astral planes, and a part of the mental planes. At one of our sessions via Lori, Jeanette said, "George, read to me the descriptions of the planes on the big colored chart which you created many years ago." I read aloud as per her request. Her comment was, "Honey, I don't know where you got that information, but I can tell you it's generally okay from my observations." So now you have at least a partial answer to question number three. Where will I, as an individual, find myself after I go through the door marked New Beginnings? When you measure yourself against the foregoing diagram, you can then decide on which plane you want to function after you shed your physical body. Ticket to a happy forever. Admit one. Next performance. Notice the logo, There is no physical body energy field. That is left behind. Only your mind, memory banks, personality, and soul will be admitted. It would perhaps be wise to start now to make some time payments toward the purchase of your ticket. You can be sure the seat will be reserved for you. However, you have to decide now, before you cast off your physical body, how much you are willing to pay for your ticket. So, if you think you will wait until you get to the pearly gate, sorry, that's too late. Do you want your reservation in section A, B, or C? Remember, no one can avoid making a choice, but Jeanette and I are happy in the knowledge that it is within the power of each of you to live a happy forever. Thank you.